What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In the previous video of this series, we introduced unit testing, TDD, and testing frameworks. Therefore, if you have no idea what TDD or unit testing in general is, I strongly suggest you watch that video before proceeding with this one. Now, before I write my first line of testing code, I want to talk about the most basic word in unit testing, one that we will use all the time. And that word is assert. To assert is to state something that is true, that I consider a fact. I assert that water boils at 100 degrees. I'm not asking a question. It's not an if statement. I'm not trying to change a behavior depending on whether I am right or wrong. You can also assert negative stuff like water does not boil at 50 degrees. This is not my opinion. This is something I consider to be a fact. Now, it is possible that an assertion I make is wrong. But if my assertion is wrong, then there is something fundamentally flawed with whatever I'm talking about. Let's take this idea over to programming. We can make assertions at any point in our code using the assert keyword in Java. So at some point in my code, I assert that these two strings are equal, or that this object is not null. I'm not asking a question. This is more of a sanity check in the code. Assertions are way different than conditions and if statements. If an assertion fails, then your code is broken. Something is wrong in your development. You need to find out why that thing you asserted is not true. So an assertion failing is not an issue to be programmatically handled in your code. We want the application to shut down as soon as possible. There's no point in going forward. If we continue and our earlier logic is flawed, we may have really bad side effects. Actually, there are only two possible options for an assertion. If what you assert is true, nothing happens. We just keep on going to the next line of code. But if what you assert is false, there's a fundamental problem in the code, and the assert statement will immediately throw an error. Remember, we're not trying to run this assert and then follow it with an if statement to check the result of doing the assert. We simply assert something, and only if the assert fails, we will notice any impact. So, is this what we're doing in this series? Well, no, certainly not. I would not associate a simple assert statement with the term unit test. It's really just a one-line sanity check. What we're doing here is not just adding asserts here and there. We'll be creating entirely new and separate unit tests and test classes. In these classes, we will be asserting stuff, yes, and because we will be using JUnit as our testing framework, you'll find multiple prepared, friendly, and easy-to-use assert methods. You won't have to deal with the basic assert keyword built directly into the language. So, you might see lines like assert equals that takes two arguments you are assuming to be equal. There are even some specialized methods for checking equality, like assert array equals, and this could take two object arrays, two integer arrays, whatever you have. But we have other assert methods. We have things like assert not null. If the object is null, this would throw an error. The flip side of that is assert null. Also, as you know, when comparing objects, there's a big difference between having two objects equal in value or references. So in JUnit, if we want to check that two object references are the same underlying object, we can use assert same, and its flip side, assert not same. More generally, we have things like assert true with a condition or assert false with a condition. Now, all of these assert methods are void. They don't return a value, you just call them directly, passing in whatever parameters or conditions that you want to assert. They either pass and continue onto the next statement, or they fail and throw an error. But hey, I'm not trying to get you to remember all of these methods here. I'm just showing you one of the benefits of using a unit testing framework. Also, keep in mind that the end goal of a unit test is to support us in making some assertions. Meaning, if we create this object and call this method passing in these values, we may then assert a result. And because whatever we assert, we assume to be true, successful assertions, successful tests, simply continue. The only ones we want to bring our attention to are the ones with failed assertions. These unit testing frameworks will help us do the initial setup if we need to create new objects or use sample data in our tests. They will help us run multiple tests at the same time, and so on. But for now, let's focus on writing one particular test with a TDD test-first mindset. So I'm beginning with nothing, no code written at all. And let's say what I have in mind is to make a very simple banking application. Okay, I know it's a little conventional, but I'm not looking to make a cool project here. I'm looking for clarity on these ideas. And with the bank account, we have easy concepts, like balances, withdrawals, deposits, and so on. Let us begin by imagining the simplest bank account class we can possibly have alongside a very straightforward UML version of this class. So it's just a field to hold balance, a deposit method, and a withdraw method. Now, I know you could take this, bring up your code editor, and write this class in probably just a few seconds. But before doing that, let's quickly think what a simple test for this class might be. We'd create a new bank account object, then we'd call the deposit method, passing in any value, and check that the balance was indeed updated. Then we'd withdraw a certain amount from this balance and check that the amount was withdrawn. Now, sometimes you might encounter technical concerns, like what's the best data type I should use for the balance? Do I need a unique ID for my account? Or business problems, like if there is a limitation on the maximum amount to withdraw at any one time. For the time being, let's keep those aside, and let's do some test-driven development. I have no code at all, I have an empty project here, and I know I want to make that simple bank account class I described a moment ago. So we won't begin by adding that class, but by first adding a unit test. Now at this point I am used to hear a little bit of resistance, like, how am I supposed to create a meaningful unit test when I have nothing to test? Well, it is true that we have no code, but we do have an intention. We know that we want to make a bank account class. So let's name the test class we want to create bank account test. I will talk about naming conventions and annotations in the next video of the series, but for now this is perfect. Okay, what we know so far is that we want to create a new instance of this bank account class, then call the deposit method and check or assert whether that worked. Notice how after adding every line of code, you can see that we get several errors and IntelliJ can see that there is no bank account class. We're not even able to compile. IntelliJ, like many IDEs, will help you generate the missing code. In our case, you can go ahead and click Alt-Enter, and an option to create the bank account class will pop up. I'll accept that while leaving all the default options. If we jump back over the test, you will see that we're not getting any complaints on that first line. But we still have a few on the second because it's detecting that there is no deposit method in the bank account class. Also, we do have another quick fix available. So I'll select that and leave the method as is for now. Jump back over the test code and finally, it is complaining about this last line here, the assertion. We are comparing the balance in the account object with the explicit value of 100, but there is no balance attribute. So let's go ahead and add it using the quick fix as well. Again, I am intentionally adding the simplest thing that could possibly work. In my final code, would the balance of a bank account class be a public integer? Certainly not. But I'm not worrying about that right now. I'm just trying to get this test to run. So let's go ahead and run it now that it's compiling. Our first failing unit test in IntelliJ with JUnit. In our last video, you probably heard the three-word phrase, red, green, refactor, as a quick summary of the test-driven development cycle. Red, make your test fail. Green, make your test pass. Refactor, make the code right. Our assertion is failing, but why? Well, it's because the deposit method may actually exist, but it's stripped of any functionality. What we need to do is add the input parameter to the balance. After doing that, run the test again. Now we have a green test. We passed our first test. And here's the thing. If I had not been talking and talking, this would have taken me, what, seconds? And this is exactly how fast you would expect to work in test-driven development. Notice how we continuously shifted from writing test code to writing application code and back again. And this is not what some people initially fear. We create a massive test project, we work on that for a while, and then we switch everything over to regular code, and we work on that for a while, and switch back over to the test. No, this is instant. In test-driven development, we do start with the test first, but we're often over to the application code in seconds. And then you start flipping continuously back and forth between the test and the application code. What takes time is just applying this idea and its concepts. Okay, so that's what test-driven development is. Red, green, refactor, and then repeat that. But how do we do it? That's the main question now. What makes a good test? How many tests should I have? What do I do with my test when I'm done? And it's these questions, and quite a few others, that we will be getting into in the next video of this series. So, stay tuned! And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching, take care, and I will see you in the next one.